We have done many, many broadcasts with the two artists sitting across the table from me today, but, we haven't done them together. And so I'm very pleased that Eric Friedman and Nadia Reisenberg have met each other, and not only that, but are going to be performing together at the 92nd Street Y concert on the 11th of October. So a welcome to Eric, welcome to my mother.
Thank you.
Good to have you both back.
Always nice to be here.
Yes, it certainly is.
Eric, tell us what's happening, because you are involved with three programs at the Y.
Yes, I'm very fortunate to be involved with a program of sonatas given at the Y, kind of dedicated to playing some of the staples of the literature, as well as some of the lesser-known sonatas that are not generally played. And I must say that to play the first concert with Nadia Reisenberg, I don't want to say that she's your mother, but I think people know that, is a concert that I am truly looking forward to, like I don't remember ever looking to forward to a concert
like
this.
Thank you. My goodness.
Well, you know
an introduction.
What always intrigues me, I've had this sense of discovery many, many times during my life, but I am always intrigued at the fact that two players who have grown up in different schools and different areas, have never met, will come together, and within a matter of, how many rehearsals have you had together? Two or three,
well,
or something?
Well, don't let's tell, because it's too few yet.
All right, but I mean, within a very, very short space of time, are able to become a team in that sense, absolute
partner. In order to form a successful sonata team, I think that two things are important. One is for both players to be musicians. In other words, many rehearsals, I think some of the students listening to this might strike a responsive chord in them. And that very often they're more or less rehearsing their own inadequacies rather than rehearsing the piece itself. They're rehearsing their problems with intonation or rehearsing their own problems with time. This should all be before the rehearsal. But the most important thing, and I don't mean to be facetious, a violinist must play like a pianist and a pianist must play like a violinist in order to be a successful sonata team.
Well, I'll ask Mother how she plays like a violinist in a moment, but how do you play like a pianist? Wait a minute.
The articulation, the intonation, and the articulation is the most is of great necessity, the ability not to rush, to play in the framework of the passage itself. And as far as I think that that Miss Reisenberg will speak for herself, but it's a question of her own... the sound she makes, I think, speaks for itself. That's why it really inspires me, and I'm not being diplomatic or cute on the radio.
All right, now wait a second. How do you play like a
violin? Well,
like a
how many times I have talked to you about it, and each time said that if we pianists have anything to envy the violinists, it's their bowing. And it is precisely that which I'm trying to produce, a bow where a bow doesn't exist. And that means legato, singing tone, and so on. Mm-hmm. A continuity of line, which you see, the nature of the piano is, after all, it's like an instrument that you hit notes with. But we want not to hit notes, we just want to feel them.
Now look, would you go back to the point that I raised originally?
Yes.
When you encounter a new musician, a new artist to play together with, how do you establish that almost instant rapport? Now, if you go to 10 violin concerts, you will hear 10 interpretations, 10 different concepts of the pieces involved. If you go to 10 piano recitals, the same thing. Now, when a pianist meets a violinist, how does this mesh? How do you all of a sudden find yourself agreeing with Eric? And Eric, how do you find yourself agreeing with Mother in that short space of time?
Well, let us say this. First of all, the musicians have to be not only musicians, but also experienced musicians. For example, I could sit down and play with a violinist who is, let's say, very erratic in his tastes and will do all sorts of incredible things. While I will be doing with him, of course, I'll go along. And there is a momentary, I can adjust then. That doesn't mean that I would leave it this way if we started to rehearse and if this would not be what I believe in or what I think is an exaggeration or in poor taste. But I could be with him together anyhow, even if he wanted to make many accelerandos, many retards, and so on and so on. So if you have experience, you can do that. However, when two musicians, experienced ones, sit down and play together, and somehow these very retards or moving forward, we are compatible in the sense that this is precisely or approximately the way I would have wanted anyhow, then of course you feel a particular affinity then it is a pleasure. Then you don't have to, at the rehearsal, start saying, "No, please don't make this kind of rubato, this kind of accelerando." We just have to adjust here and there a few things, or accommodate, for example, or say, "I have a big stretch, give me," or "big jump, give me a little time." Those are the things we arrange. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, we listen to each other. I mean, you just listen, and you can predict. If somebody wants to slow down, you can predict it. Now, when I accompany, let's say, a concerto, and I see that the student is lagging, I can prompt him if I want to. I'll give a nice, strong accent, and I will make it very clear to him, go on, you see? Uh-huh. But when we are playing together, that is not the time to do it.
Exactly.
I think speaking in the purely mundane sense, most people think that when two artists get together, what they're trying to do is interpret, so to speak, in quotation marks. They're trying to do something original. They're trying to, in some way, warp the phrase in order to make
an effect.
To make an effect. Yeah. This isn't true at all. A true artist is looking for truth. He's looking for what's in the music, not what's in himself. Mm. As a matter of fact, the self-effacement necessary to be an important artist, to be somebody that says something, is something that is relegated to the real performer.
Or the opposite. when there is, let's say, I have a figuration, I'm listening then not to my own figuration, I'm listening to the tune which is being at the moment played by the other instrument, you see.
Very good. Now, what I would like to do, tell us, Eric, how the programs have been set up, the three Y concerts.
Yes.
The first one, of course, is with Nadia Reisenberg. That's the 11th of October. These are all Tuesday nights. The other two are set... How?
Well, you mean the programming?
Yeah.
The first one is the Kreutzer Sonata and the Strauss Sonata that we'll play some of, and the Brahms, D minor. Mm-hmm. The second program is devoted to the Prokofiev F minor, the Crigliano Sonata. That's one of the great modern sonatas of today.
Gian Crigliano.
Mm-hmm. And what else am I doing? Saint-Saëns. So many I can't remember. And then
by the way, is with James Dick.
James Dick, so a very, very fine pianist. And Ivan Davis is playing with me the third program in January, mm-hmm. whatever date it is, I don't remember.
That's the 24th, I have.
The 24th, yes, and I'm playing the Fauré, Debussy, and Franck sonatas with him.
The A major?
Yes.
Fauré.
Yes.
Very nice indeed.
First
All right, we are going to take a short time out here for a weather report and a couple of other announcements, and then... Well, we will get to preview the Y concert right here in our listening room. We've been visiting today with Eric Friedman and Nadia Reisenberg. As I mentioned, they will be performing at the 92nd Street Y. This will be on Tuesday, October 11th. And on the program then, the Strauss Sonata. We do not have time for the entire work today, but we will hear the first two movements played right here in the studio.